Good evening. Good evening, everybody, and welcome. My name is Gabrielle Kelly, and I'm the Director of the Office of External Relations in the Department of Premier and Cabinet. And I was running down the road between Victoria Square and my office on North Terrace today, soaking wet, dripping hair, really water dripping off me. And I stopped by the lights and bumped into this fellow and I said, really, it's like from the sublime to the ridiculous, isn't it? He said, no, it's like from the ridiculous to the sublime, which I agreed with. So those of you who've come through the rain and the difficult traffic, thank you so much for being here. I expect that we'll still have guests coming in and they're welcome, but we'll get proceedings going because it's pretty crazy out there tonight. May I firstly acknowledge this land that we meet on today is the traditional land of the Kaurna people and that we respect their spiritual relationship to their country. We also acknowledge the Kaurna people as the custodians of the Adelaide region and that their cultural and heritage beliefs are still as important to the living Kaurna people today. To Professor Martin Seligman, welcome back to Adelaide. It's wonderful to have you here with us again. To our international guests and wellbeing experts who are in Adelaide to deliver something like 25 events in the wellbeing sessions over the next 2 weeks, may I say welcome to Brigadier General Retired Dr. Rhonda Cornham, who's been working with us, who will be working with us in a very intense 2 week period. Professor Felicia Huppert from Cambridge University and the University of Western Sydney, Dr. Peggy Kern and Mr. Johannes Eichstadt from the University of Pennsylvania, Professor Jun Fudano from the Kanazawa Institute of Technology, and Mr. Darren Coppen from Escher House. Welcome also to our South Australian wellbeing partners and leaders, the original partners in the Martin Seligman Residency and the new partners for the wellbeing sessions, whose names you can see displayed there. Now, I started to write a list of special welcomes to give to this meeting tonight, but really the list was too long. So I've now put everybody on a screen, and I want to just say that all of you are really welcome, and this is an indication of just how strong the leadership that is developing around the wellbeing work in South Australia is. So thank you very much, and particular welcome to all those people. And if there are a couple of you who I've missed, please be welcomed. You know who you are. The leadership is very diverse around South Australia. And distinguished guests all. We're very excited to have so many of you here tonight, international experts, local experts, practitioners, and committed citizens, all keen to hear about this science of, about how this science of positive psychology is advancing globally. Many of you would know that in November 2013, we launched Professor Martin Seligman's final report as Adelaide Thinker in Residence, entitled Building the State of Wellbeing, a Strategy for South Australia. We're now in the implementation phase of Professor Seligman's recommendations, moving from ideas to action, working with over 50 schools, number of sporting clubs, government departments and organisations, local government and communities of all kinds, all beginning the journey to wellbeing. This event tonight is part of the wellbeing sessions, which is this number of 25 events which I discussed with you, and you'll see up here some of them, and you can find more information about what's going on in the next week and a half by looking at that website. While I was thinking about what to say to you, Nad, I found myself asking this question. Why are so many international guests with us here during this period? Why did the president of Tecno Milenio University Mexico come to Adelaide last week with a number of other esteemed academics to talk to Mount Barker High School and St Peter's College Adelaide last week? Why has Professor Jun Fudano from the Kanazawa Institute of Technology Japan come back to Adelaide for a second visit? Why did 9,000 people come to events and meetings during Professor Seligman's last visit? And why are another 4,000 people coming to events over the next 2 weeks? Why have at least 6 schools in the northern suburbs travelled to Geelong Grammar School to learn about positive psychology, many of them in a car together, I think laughing and singing all the way? Why is Geelong Grammar coming to Adelaide to train another 200 teachers later this year? And why is Melbourne University offering training with St Peter's College Adelaide on positive psychology also later this year? Why are more and more young students working on gratitude trees in schools across the state? The reason is that this is the response to an amazing interest, demand and commitment that has been unleashed in the population to build South Australia as a state of wellbeing by measuring, embedding and building wellbeing science here in many different organisations of many different kinds. So it's happening. Here in South Australia, we are deeply engaged in building wellbeing across our state and learning how to do this. But meanwhile, of course, the academic world continues to develop the science of wellbeing. And tonight, in a while, Martin is going to provide an overview of some of the cutting-edge developments in the science of wellbeing, positive psychology and emerging trends. But before we go to Dr. Seligman, Professor Seligman, and by the way, we will hear from Professor Seligman for about 50 minutes and then we'll have a short Q&A afterwards. Most of you, I think, are familiar with that method that we use, and I know that Martin enjoys. I would like to just introduce you to Jane Burns, who is the Associate Professor and Chief Executive Officer of the Young and Well Cooperative Research Centre, with some very exciting news for South Australia. The Young and the Well Cooperative Research Centre's research explores young people's use of technology and its impact on mental health and wellbeing. Jane's going to describe a very exciting project to you, which we will launch tonight. May I welcome Jane Burns.
I'm absolutely delighted to be here tonight. I'm actually a Port Pirie girl myself, born and bred, and went to Adelaide University. And it just gives me great delight. And I don't know if you were listening to the music earlier, but there was a song from Little Things, Big Things Grow. And probably about 2 years ago, Gabby and I sat and talked about the Thinkers in Residence program and how we could work in partnership to really position South Australia as a state that could lead the world in positive psychology. And about the same time, I was having conversations with Professor Malcolm Battersby, who's standing behind me. It feels a bit like a guard of honour, but that's lovely, from Flinders University. Malcolm heads up, is head of psychiatry there. And the wonderful Rebecca Graham from Country Health South Australia, she's the Executive Director of Mental Health. And we somehow got our heads together and with our partners, reachout.com, said, how do we actually work in partnership with young people, with professionals, with researchers and with service providers to really make a difference in the field of positive psychology? So this gives me huge delight to be here to tell you a little bit about this project. And I suppose a little bit about the role of technology and how we see technologies playing a significant part in the lives of young people, but what it might mean in terms of positive psychology and how you can take that fantastic science and really take it to the masses. And so for any of you who are young people, and I can see plenty of you in the audience tonight, this won't be news to you, but for parents and for teachers, what we're seeing is this pervasive use of technology, and certainly from our research, we know that 99% of young people are using technologies, and it means that they have access to both negative things, but also the potential to have access to wonderful things, to feel connected, to feel valued, to grow really strong relationships. And so this is a stat from one of our national surveys, which says that young people are accessing the internet on their mobile phones. So what it means in terms of when you think about mental health and when you think about well-being, we have an opportunity to take our learnings into the hands of young people and make it available to them literally 24/7 when they might need it. Now, we obviously want to do that with respect and ensure that they're not overwhelmed with the use of technologies. But really, we have this opportunity for the first time in history to really reduce the disparities in access to healthcare, but to also promote the very positive things that come from feeling valued, being connected, and being a part of a community. So I don't want to dismiss the fact that our young people, particularly our young people in rural, regional, and remote communities, are not doing so well. And this again comes from our national survey. And the things that stood out for me particularly were our young people are really struggling with coping with stress. Body image is an issue for young people. It's not just for young women, it's also an issue for young men. Bullying, emotional abuse, depression, drugs, self-harm. And again, to bring into the positive psychology realm, what we're trying to do is say, yes, we understand that these are the mental health issues facing young people, but if we can flip that on its head and say that our young people have such wonderful opportunities to flourish, that's where our energy should focus. We don't want to reduce the opportunity for access to service, but we really want to think about what does it mean to improve mental health, to improve well-being, to grow resilience, and to do it in a way that is all-encompassing and across communities. So when we talk about inner regional and rural remote, probably 10 years ago, people would say, oh, well, if you live in a rural community, you don't have access to technologies, you don't have access to the internet. Again, this is our national survey data. 95% of young people in inner regional, 88% in rural remote, 92% of young people using social networks. And when you think about the things that make positive psychology so wonderful, the sense of connectedness, the networking that might happen, the building of positive relationships, it makes sense that we think about the role of organisations like Facebook in actually taking on some of that knowledge and using it to build much more positive relationships in these environments. So the mental health and wellbeing of young people in inner regional and rural remote areas, and again, this won't come as a surprise to us given the work, wonderful work that's being done in our local communities and having grown up in local Port Pirie. We know that young people who live in country communities do tend to struggle, and yet they have an inner resilience that we want to really build on. So we know that young people are reporting that they don't feel that their life is worth living. 16% felt that life was hardly worth living. 14% thought that they would be better off dead. And what we want to do is really shift that statistic. We've got something to work with. We want to reduce that and absolutely increase, and I think Martin will talk to the importance of measuring wellbeing, and really increase that statistic so that these stats lower. So to introducing young and well towns, and I certainly hope and look to engage you over the course of the period of time, the aim really is to work directly with young people. Young people are the single most important people who have voice in this space. They will drive change, they will own change, they will seek to change. And we want them to be positioned alongside our health professionals, our teachers and our parents. There are a number of great resources out there that are built on the work of positive psychology over the last 20 years, but what we want to do is make it relevant to those local communities. And I'm so proud and pleased to say, and Malcolm was telling me about Murray Bridge tonight. Murray Bridge is our first pilot site. We're working with Headspace there to really look at, well, how can you actually increase access and use these resources so that they are available to young people? The second part of the project, and I don't know if there is anyone here from reachout.com, but really is saying, given that young people are using technologies, they're using apps, they're online, they're accessing services, what does it look like to create a virtual wellbeing centre where you actually position all of these apps so that they are available? So that if coping with stress is an issue, you can download an app about coping with stress. If you want to participate in mindfulness, there is an app for that. And so again, with our partners, we're looking at what that wellbeing toolbox might look like and how that can be delivered across all of our schools across country South Australia, and how that might mean that young people who are living in those communities actually have access to the wonderful work that comes from positive psychology in the last 20 years of building on that. Finally, I want to finish by talking about paying it forward. I think often there is a conversation about what this might mean for all schools and all communities. And I was so pleased to be at the Positive Psychology Conference last week where Simon was talking about the work that Saints has led with a number of schools and that Matthew's been leading as well. And I want to introduce you to the PISA website. It is about paying it forward. It's saying, how do we actually take the knowledge that we might have and that we've learnt from our schools and actually make it available to all schools? And so I want to finish on that note. I am very, very excited to be working with South Australia, very excited to be a part of the positive psychology movement and have, you know, sort of driven that for the last 20 years. And it's fabulous to be here tonight with such wonderful people who are looking at building partnerships with young people, professionals, parents, teachers, educators, and across the community more broadly. So thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you so much. That's a very exciting project, and it's great to see partnerships between such powerful organisations really moving forward. Now, one of the other organisations that will be instrumental in the vision of making South Australia a state of wellbeing is SAMRI, the South Australian Health and Medical Research Institute, that incredible building that we have seen growing, you know, as if by magic from the ground up in the middle of the new biomedical research area. SAMRI is a vital link between South Australia and the international health and medical research community. And of course, they have three of Adelaide's great universities on their board and working in concert with them. And they can help us as we move from theory into practice, but with a strong commitment to keeping the scientific rigour at the centre of all our efforts. We welcome their participation and their leadership in this vision. There's no reason that I can think of why South Australia cannot become an Australasian leader of global research efforts into social wellbeing within about 5 years. There's no reason why South Australia cannot attract more of the world's great wellbeing academics and leaders to help us with that task. I now welcome Professor Steve Wesseling, the Executive Director of the South Australian Health and Medical Research Institute, to the stage to welcome Professor Seligman. Thank you, Steve.
Thanks, Gabe. And it's a great pleasure to be here and a fantastic crowd. So welcome from SAMRI as well. As the Executive Director of SAMRI, really my job and SAMRI's job is to gather the evidence to develop the health and medical research that we can then utilise to improve health in South Australia, Australia and across the world. And tonight really is one of those opportunities of linking evidence with the work that can really improve health and well-being. As you know, South Australia is really trying to position itself in the area of health and medical research, in the industry of health, to really do some very special things. And obviously our building, which you could see when the blinds were up, but is just over there, is part of that, as is the development of that precinct with the new Royal Adelaide and the universities joining us on that precinct. But also the partnership that has worked so well with SAMRE, with the three universities and the health delivery sector, in really looking at what are the critical questions to ask, what are the evidence that we can produce and how we can produce health. And we're really keen to link that strategy, which is already working well, with Professor Seligman's work on well-being. And the way we want to do that is to really make that part of our mind and brain theme. So we have seven themes, but one of our critical themes is the mind and brain theme, led by Giulio Lincinio. And the mind and brain theme is very much going to be looking at that continuum between mental health and well-being, and looking at the evidence that supports the work in that area and how we can make the very best interventions. And so at the one end, we're going to be looking at things like imaging and genetics and others, and at the other end, we're going to be looking at the issues of well-being, which we're going to hear about tonight. And we really think that's a very, very exciting prospect. And in a couple of months, we're actually going to launch the SAMRE Wellbeing and Resilience Centre, and that's going to sit inside our mind and brain theme. And really what that's going to supply, I think, is an ongoing leadership and ongoing academic leadership, ongoing research and evidence gathering in the area of well-being, linked, as I said, to that continuum from mental health to well-being. And I think that really is going to have a significant impact in South Australia, linking with all the other works that we've heard about just now, all the other agencies that are working, the schools, etc., that are really making South Australia such a centre for well-being in the country and globally. Professor Seligman's dashboard of well-being, positive emotion, engagement, relationships, meaning and accomplishment is a proven measure of well-being. And those tools are now well validated, and there are tested methods to improve well-being. So bringing that together, as I said, with the work of all the agencies, the work that we're going to do at SAMRE, we can really position South Australia as the first state to really take all this together, to measure what we're doing, to implement well-being strategies and demonstrate the outcomes of those strategies, which I think are truly going to be truly exciting. This, of course, means that we're developing new knowledge, that we're translating that new knowledge into health and into outcomes. But the field continues to grow, and I think we're very lucky to have Martin as part of this process, and we're very lucky to have Martin here tonight. What we're going to do over the period is obviously tap into Martin's expertise, his understanding of the science, his understanding of where the cutting edge of that science is, what's happening globally, and hopefully on a regular basis, Martin's going to come and tell us what's happening and obviously give us counsel on how we're proceeding and how we're improving well-being in South Australia. But that's part of what tonight's about, because tonight Martin is one of those occasions where Martin's going to come along and tell us what's happening in the science, what are the most exciting developments in well-being, and I'm really looking forward to hearing about that, Martin. So on behalf of SAMRE, on behalf of all the people in the audience, and on behalf of South Australia, welcome, and come to the stage and tell us what's exciting in well-being, Martin. Thank you very much.
A state of well-being. Creating a state of well-being. Well, I picked up the paper this morning and looked at 6% unemployment in Australia, the closing of the Holden plant, increasing ratio of very rich people to very poor people. So the question is, why would you listen to a talk on well-being, given these dismal statistics? What have we been smoking? So what I want to try to do tonight is, without diminishing the pain of unemployment, economic prospects that are less than excellent, I want to talk about what is the relationship between the pocketbook, between economics and well-being. Well, it turns out they're not remotely identical. And it's very interesting to me that our government, our newspapers, same in America, are totally dominated by economic news and not about the well-being of a nation. So underlying question is, what should public policy be about? So public policy is dominantly directed toward GDP, toward unemployment, toward narrowing the ratio of the rich to the poor. But that kind of public policy turns out not to be identical with the increasing of well-being. And just a few teasers before I go on. Many of us have been very interested in the relationship of how much you earn of wealth to life satisfaction. And universally, both at the individual level and at the national level, the curve looks like this, which is to say, if you're poor, oh, Rex, hello, how good to see you. If you're poor, increasing wealth up to a decent safety net increases well-being in lockstep. But as individuals and nations become wealthier, and I'm going to hazard a guess that the mean income of this group, probably about $60,000 or $70,000 a year. When you get to that stage, increases in wealth produce almost no increases in well-being. The ratio of the rich to the poor. So there's a lot of talk these days about how awful it is that billionaires and very poor people, and people compute the ratio. There's quite a bit of literature on what is the relationship between the ratio. And it turns out that it's very small. It accounts for, if you look across 200 nations and you plot the gap between the rich and the poor, it accounts for about 1% of differences in life satisfaction. And very interestingly, if you look at whether or not people think the gap is fair, that is, whether or not people believe in upward mobility, it turns out the relationship completely vanishes. So in a nation like Canada, where there's a very big gap between the rich and the poor, statistically, people believe it's fair, and there's no relationship. Whereas in Brazil, also a very big gap, people believe it's unfair and corrupt. And there, the ratio makes a difference for well-being. So in many ways, the theme of what I want to talk about tonight is why should we care about well-being? And I want to contrast that to, I think, the dominant political view, which is homo economicus, that we really are creatures of the pocketbook. That view turns out to be empirically false, morally insidious, and politically, I believe, a dead end. And so what I want to talk about tonight is what we know on the cutting edge of well-being. And as we do this, I'll try to say something about the juxtaposition of the view that human beings are economic versus human beings are something much larger than that. I believe we are creatures who pursue well-being. And one of our means of doing that is economic, but it's a minor, relatively minor influence on well-being. In order to calibrate what I'm going to do tonight, I need to know how many of you have been to one of my major lectures before. Okay, so about half of you. So I'll try to skip fairly rapidly about stuff you've heard before. So here's the outline of what I intended to do tonight. And I changed it. When I picked up the newspaper this morning, I decided I would try to move things in the direction of contrasting Homo economicus to a human species that wants to build well-being and the difference. So to do that, I have to talk about what is well-being. And as half of you know, I believe the definition of the elements of well-being is what do free human beings who are not suffering pursue in their own right? And I believe there are five such elements. The first is happiness, positive emotion, subjective well-being, feeling good. I think we pursue that. The second, but we're not just hedonic creatures. So not only are we not creatures of the dollar, but we're also just not just creatures of feeling good. We pursue engagement, being one with the music, being at home, being time-stopping for us. This is one of the one of the highest states we can pursue. We pursue, that's the E, engagement. We pursue for its own sake good relationships with people, whether or not it brings happiness, whether or not it brings engagement. But we are hive creatures. We're social creatures. We pursue meaning and purpose, being belonging to and serving something bigger than we are. Now, notice as I'm saying these things, the view of Homo economicus says, well, no, we're pursuing dollars. But when you juxtapose meaning and purpose to dollars, there are plenty of you who are pursuing meaning and purpose at the expense of dollars. Those of you who teach school, who do public service and the like. And finally, very importantly, we do pursue economic things. We pursue the A, which is accomplishment, mastery, achievement. And for some of us, that's measured in dollars. For others of us, it's measured in other ways. So for me, well-being is the pursuit of PERMA. And the measure of a state of well-being is the success that the citizens have in pursuing well-being. So how do you measure that? How do you know if people in South Australia are in a state of well-being? So I want to spend about 10 minutes, one of the most exciting aspects that's happened since last time I was here is big improvements in the measurement of well-being. So I'm going to talk about how to measure PERMA, and two of our University of Pennsylvania people, Peggy Kern and Johannes Eichstadt, are here, and they're going to talk at length tomorrow, I think at Samurai, about these developments. So I'm going to talk about how to measure PERMA, and this is a revolution in measurement. It's the big data revolution. So I'll talk about that for about 10 minutes or so. And then the question of how to build PERMA. And many of you have heard this before. There is knowledge about how to build it at the individual level. The state of South Australia is one of the best examples in the world of this being done at more than the individual level, of this being done at schools and in the mental health system. Mental health has typically been a euphemism for mental illness. But I'm proud to say that there's movement in South Australia in which people are seeing mental health not just as the absence of being crazy, not just the absence of mental illness, but as the presence of PERMA. So I'll talk about what we know about building it for positive emotion, for engagement, for relationships, for meaning and purpose, and for accomplishment. And then I'm going to suggest to you something I really learned in South Australia, at Mount Barker, and at Saints, and that I think the exercises that we've spent so much time, gratitude visits, three blessings, are not where the action is going to be about the increase of PERMA. But I'm going to suggest to you that increasing PERMA is local. And Adam Smith, in talking about how money functions hit on it, an invisible hand argument that when we decide that PERMA is a value in a school, in a mental health system, in a corporation, and we measure it, and people are held accountable for the building of PERMA, they find local ways of increasing PERMA. So I want to stress the invisible hand. And then as I get to the end of this, I'll say a little bit about what's new in positive education. There is a major new finding in positive education. I'll tell you the nub of it. A couple of months ago, I gave a speech at number 10 Downing Street because there is a movement in England to do positive education. The Minister of Education, Michael Gove, doesn't really like this positive education stuff. He says, why would we waste money on building character and building happiness and building meaning when what we want is numeracy and literacy? So what is the evidence that by having our young people learn happiness, meaning and purpose, good character, that they will achieve more in the world? Really quite unknown. So we put a white paper together in which we assembled the evidence on the building of PERMA and its relationship to increasing achievement. So if you're a Michael Gove type and all you care about is increasing literacy, numeracy, and achievement, does making people happy get in the way of that and waste our time, or does it increase? And the answer in our white paper, it increases. And then just last month, Alejandro Adler came back from his two-year 18-school well-being building in Bhutan, and I'll present his results on well-being and achievement in a randomized experiment in all of Bhutan. Since we have Rhonda Cornum here, who is the heroine of comprehensive soldier fitness, I'll say a little bit about what General Cornum accomplished and what the findings of comprehensive soldier fitness are. And then I'll go back and ask the question again. What does the politics of money look like? The politics of homo economicus versus the politics of well-being? And I'm going to suggest to you that the public policy of the future must be a blend of these two, that a public policy built around the notion that we are homo economicus just is not the future. Future is building economy and building well-being. So that's what I'll do in the next half hour or so. What is it for a human being or a state to flourish? It is a dashboard. So sometimes people are tempted to say, is there one number that we can measure in South Australia that will tell us whether or not we're increasing or decreasing our flourishing? And the answer, I'm afraid, is no. And here's the metaphor for that. If you're piloting an airplane, you're flying from Sydney to Adelaide, and you've got a whole dashboard of instruments, there's no one gauge that tells you how the airplane is doing. It depends on your mission. So if your mission is to get from Sydney to Adelaide as quickly as possible, then you want it's the speed gauges and the wind gauges that you care about. If it's to get there as economically as possible, it's the fuel gauge you care about. If it's to get there as comfortably as possible with the least turbulence, it's the radar and going around the thunderstorms that matter. Well, with PERMA, human beings are much more complicated than airplanes, and there are five gauges that matter to us, and they matter differently to different people. So some people are hedonists. They leave their lives around pleasure, and that's the P in PERMA. Others of us are engagement people, people for whom being in flow is really what matters. And it should be said that on the modification of these matters, which is a very important thing for education, hedonic things, being cheerful, smiling, being merry, doesn't change very much. A positive affectivity is normally distributed. That means half the world right now isn't feeling good. And the data are that when you do interventions, you can increase the amount you smile by between 5 and 15%. But you can't change curmudgeons into cheerleaders. And so if you think positive psychology is about making people smile more, then you're sadly mistaken. Positive psychology is about a dashboard. One of the things is smiling more, but that has great limitations. The second is being in flow more, being engaged. And the main thing we know about being engaged when time stops for you when you're using your highest skills and your highest strengths to meet the challenges that come your way. That's when you go into flow. And we can have more of that in our schools, in our corporations, in our relationships. So the third element of the flourishing human being is good relationships. The fourth element is meaning and purpose, and the final element is accomplishment. Now, how do we measure these things? Measurement is terrifically important, and it's not at all a boring subject. If you don't measure the right thing, you don't do the right thing. And one of the problems about Homo economicus and public policy is the only thing we measured from the Industrial Revolution on was money. Well, money is important. Well-being goes with it in a diminishing returns. But if that's all you measure, and what you really care about is building the well-being of the people you love or of the state you live in, money is not going to tell you that. So you have to measure well-being if that's what you care about. Now, 30 years ago, there were no good measures of well-being. And then in the last 30 years, about 25 different questionnaires about well-being, about meaning, about how happy you are, about how engaged you are, grew up. So we could measure it reasonably well. And I have a website called authentichappiness.org. That has the 20 leading tests of well-being on it. They're free. 3.5 million people have registered at that website and taken the tests. So if you want to know where kindness sits in your life relative to Australian women over 40, you can actually find out on that website. But there is something new under the sun. And it turns out that each of these is teachable. I should say the reason I spent the first 35 years of my professional life working on misery, suicide, depression, hopelessness, helplessness. And people used to say, well, why don't you work on happiness, Dr. Seligman? And the reason I didn't was actually a study that crippled us. So in 1974, Phil Brickman found 14 people who had won the Illinois lottery. And he measured their happiness before and after. And what he found was for the first 3 months after you win $1 million, you become happier. But 3 months later, you're back where you were. You're back to your usual curmudgeonly self. And so scientists like I said, misery is the real thing, and happiness, well-being is just the froth on the cappuccino, but the suffering and misery were the espresso. And that turned out to be wrong. So some of the evidence I'll talk to you about tonight actually says you can have more positive emotion in your life, in the life of South Australia, than there is now. You can be more engaged with the people you love than you are now. You can have better relationships. You can have more meaning and purpose in life. And you can have better accomplishment. But the key to all that is measurement. And so if I ask you, Matthew, how happy are you today? You can give me a number, but it turns out your reputation managing, there's a huge amount of slop in between a psychologist standing in front of you and asking how you're doing. Now, where this comes into play is 3 years ago, the Prime Minister of the UK, David Cameron, said that he will measure the well-being of the British Isles and hold himself accountable for the success or failure of public policy by changes in well-being. I'm a member of his statistical committee, and what we do is every 3 months we phone 200,000 Brits and we ask them, how are you feeling today? Well, you get approximations of what's going on, but the questionnaires have so many artifacts that I'm not really happy about them. 2 years ago, when I was here, I met John Hill, the Minister of Education. Is John here by any chance? He said something. I told him about big data and what we were just starting to do. So what we're starting to do is there are hundreds of millions of tweets every day, hundreds of millions of Facebook statuses. People are saying what's on their mind en masse. And it turns out PERMA has a lexicon. So there are, in English, about 45,000 words and phrases, and our lexicon grows every day, that are about P and anti-P, about happy and unhappy. And so what you can do is you can comb through this vast treasury of big data and ask what people are saying, how much PERMA and anti-PERMA words are being deployed. So if you're Mr. Cameron and you decide to build a library in Manchester, what you're trying to do is increase intellectual engagement in the citizens, particularly the kids of Manchester. Well, you could go and say, you know, David, how much do you like the library? But instead, what I think you should do, and the sort of thing we do now, is comb through, when you build the library, the 2,000 engagement versus boredom words. And the prediction is, if you build a library and it's worth it, engagement words will go up and anti-engagement words will go down. John Hill said, gee, that's just what I do. I'm responsible for measuring drug use in South Australia. So we don't break into people's flats and measure how much cocaine they have in the flats. We go to the sewers and we measure what the percentage of cocaine in the sewers are. And so what I'm going to talk about for the next 5 minutes or so is the sewers of the mind, which is Facebook and Twitter. So what Peggy and Johannes have led is an endeavor, it's a huge endeavor now, in which we comb through tens of millions of Facebook and tweets, and we ask what words are being used. And so what I'm going to show you now is the sort of data that emerges. How do 13 to 18-year-olds, how do you kids from Scotch differ from the young teachers around? Well, it turns out you differ markedly. Now, this is not only a colorful slide, but it's a statistically loaded slide. The bigger the word, the more statistically it's different from other age groups. So school, homework, English, tomorrow, those are tweet and Facebook words. Young adults, 23 to 29. Notice it's a completely different set of things. This is what's coming down the pike for you year 12 people. At work. New job, days off, beer, office. And interestingly, for the, this is a roughly middle age group, this is what middle age is about. And one of the nice things that Johannes and Peggy have been able to do is you cannot only look at individual words, you can look at phrases and topics. So there's a beautiful statistical ways of asking what topics do we really care about in middle age. And here it is, family, friends, wonderful, son, daughter, serving the country, freedom. These are not present in teenagers, and they're not present in 23 to 28-year-olds. Prayer, family, and God. You can also look at what it is to be a neurotic human being versus what it is to be a healthy human being. So this is based on 80 million tweets. We comb through it. We have, I believe, 70,000 people who have taken neuroticism inventories. And so we have people who are very neurotic and people who are very healthy. And then we just look at their Facebook statuses and we ask, what do they talk about? And again, the bigger the word, the more they talk about. So for neurotic people, sick of, depressed, stupid, anymore, dead, hates. Importantly, what the healthy mind is about is success, beautiful day, basketball, beach, workout. Now, this is not just about how we're feeling. This is not just about your emotions, but I've spent a lot of my life working on death and the question of who dies and who dies prematurely and who lives for a long time. This is work of Johannes Eichstadt that he'll talk about tomorrow. So here we're dealing, is it 80 million tweets, roughly? Right, there are 1,300 counties in the United States that we're able to get enough tweets from to basically analyze county by county what do the young people tweet about. And what we compared that to was the rate of cardiovascular death county by county. And the 0.67 tells you the best fit correlation of what's talked about in the counties and the rate of death. So this is the northeastern United States. On the left, you've got the death rate as reported by CDC. Red is very high death rate county by county. And on the right, you're not using any of that information. You're just looking at what's talked about on Twitter. And what you can see is these two graphs fall almost on top of each other. And if you look closely, here's what's going on. If you're at risk at the county level for heart attack, that's what you're tweeting about. Fuck, hate, bored, annoying, boobs, and the like. And if you're low risk, protective against cardiovascular disease, folks, great, interesting, conference, forward. So just to summarize what we've got here, John Hill was right. We've got a sewer here. It's much better than questionnaires, I think. It's the sewer is what kids are saying, and adults more and more are using it. And by the way, you can correct for the different age uses of this. That's a little more complicated. And we've got a new way of measuring perma and anti-perma, but not just perma and anti-perma, but the topics that are on our mind, the difference between health and illness, the difference between mental health and mental illness, the difference between physical health and physical illness. So that's something new under the sun. I'm going to talk briefly about PERMA being teachable because half of you have heard this before. I'll go quickly. Positive emotion. Can you build positive emotion? And the answer is yes, you can. And the way we do these exercises is rigorous. So every so often on my website, authentichappiness.org, we put up a link that says exercises. And if you go to that link, it says, Dr. Seligman wants to find out what really makes people happier. So from the Buddha to modern pop psychology, there have been about 200 things that people have said increases life satisfaction. So we translate these into exercises versus control groups. And if you're willing to do it, you get randomly assigned to an exercise or to a control group. And you don't know which you're in. These are all plausible exercises. So we were able to ask the question, we found about 12 different exercises that increase life satisfaction and decrease depression. And by that, I should just mention, as Jane was talking about mental illness and depression, that it's very interesting that there's increasing evidence that there just aren't enough therapists around to deal with the rate of depression you have in Australia. But and there is, I'm not going to have time to talk about, reason to believe that the antidepressant drugs are dangerous and have downsides. So what are we going to do? Well, it turns out the exercises that we've been finding here don't need face-to-face interaction. There is reason to believe these are depression decreasers. So there is a very cost-effective, this is the other side of the sewer of the media, there are very effective web exercises for increasing well-being and decreasing depression. One of them is three good things. So if your assignment is every night for the next 7 days, write down three things that went well and why they went well versus a control group. 6 months later, people who do that have significantly higher life satisfaction and significantly lower depression. So that's one thing from the P side of life. From the engagement side of life, can people become more engaged? And this is the study of character. The answer is that if you find out what your five highest strengths are, how many of you have gone to the website and taken the signature strengths test? Okay, I recommend this for all of you. It's free. It takes about 20 minutes. Over 3 million people have taken it. What this tells you is what your highest strengths are, things like gratitude, kindness, social intelligence, prudence, humor, and the like. And the reason this is important, that we find out that people who, well, we'll do it now, close your eyes, think of something you have to do at least once a week at work or at home that you really don't like doing. Okay, open your eyes. So what we found is that when people identify their highest strength and then do the thing they don't like doing using their highest strength, it becomes fun, becomes much more fun. Some of you have heard examples of this before. So if your highest strength is social intelligence, as one of my students was, who was a bagger at the supermarket, she didn't like bagging groceries. She resolved she would make the encounter with her the highlight of every customer's day. Now, obviously, she failed at making it the highlight, but she put what was best inside of her on offer, and the job went much better. So in general, we find that if you identify your highest strength and then start taking long cuts around the things you don't like doing, life satisfaction goes up and depression goes down. We have found a couple of other things en route with the building of character. We're interested, as Rhonda Cornyn can tell you, in post-traumatic growth. So we're interested in people who have gone through awful things like unemployment, rape, torture, and the like. So we asked the question, for people who have gone through that, this is a sample of 1,700 people who have gone through terrible events, who grows? Who becomes physically and psychologically stronger after awful events? And here's the answer. People who have these five strengths to begin with, religiousness, gratitude, kindness, hope, and bravery are the people who grow the most after awful events. We're also interested in professions. What profession should you enter given your strengths profile? So this graph here is very complicated statistically, but all you need to know, this is the 24 strengths. The closer together two of the strengths are, the more likely it is if you have one, then you have the other. So you can see in the upper left-hand corner that gratitude and love are close together. People who have love tend to have gratitude. And the farther apart, creativity, the less likely you are to have it if you have one. So creative people tend not to have gratitude and love. So we looked at large numbers of people in four different professions and asked, what are the strengths profile? Teachers have gratitude, love, and kindness, but they don't have bravery and love of learning and creativity. Professors have that, but professors don't have forgiveness and kindness and love. CEOs have zest and hope, but they don't have fairness and modesty and honesty and prudence. And administrators have fairness, honesty, modesty, and prudence. Then we looked at the great ones, and that's different from who's in the profession. So the question, what do the great teachers look like? And there the profiles are different. So I was shocked when I found out, Warren, the two highest strengths of great teachers. First is humor, and the second is zest. And when we think about teacher education in South Australia, I think it's not just teaching geometry to people who are going to teach math, but it's also teaching things like humor and zest and how to build character and well-being. Relationships. active constructive responding. This comes from marriage counseling. So in marriage counseling, what we used to teach people to do was how to fight better. Turns out you can, by teaching people not to have the same damn fight every day over a different issue, you can change insufferable marriages to barely tolerable marriages. So a group of positive psychology marriage counselors asked, can you change good marriages into very good marriages? So instead of asking how people fight, they asked, how do people celebrate together? So what do you say to your spouse when she comes home with a victory? She's been promoted at work. So it's a 2x2 here. What you might do, and I'm going to talk about drill sergeants in a bit, you might do active destructive. So you might say something like, you know what tax bracket that's going to put us in? That doesn't help a marriage. You might do, and this is what I did before I read the literature, passive constructive, which is, congratulations, darling, you deserve it. That has no effect. You might, and often people often do this, do passive destructive, which is, what's for dinner? The only thing that works, and now what marriage counselors teach people to do, is active constructive responding. Darling, please relive what happened. Exactly where were you when your boss told you you had been promoted, she tells you. Now, why did he say exactly you were promoted, and he tells you, she tells you. What do you think your highest strengths are that got you promoted? And how can you use these more with the kids and in church? It turns out when you teach that, sexuality, love, and commitment go up, and the rate of divorce goes down. And it's learnable. Meaning, belonging to and serving something bigger than you are. Now, this is something, an insight that most of the adults here know, but the kids from Scotch may not know. This is something that emerges in time. So I assign my students to do something fun from P, or to do something philanthropic, altruistic. And it turns out when you do, and then to report on it, and when you do something fun, like going to the movies, hanging out with friends, masturbating, it turns out that positive emotion goes up, but then it sinks beneath the waves, square wave. But when you do something altruistic, like helping another person, it lasts and lasts. And in fact, our hedonic system is wired to help other people. And I'm often asked as by depressed people, if you're one of the 15% of Australians right now who are diagnosably depressed, what's the one thing you can do in the next hour that's most likely to make you feel better? The answer is to go out and help another person. I'm not preaching here. It just turns out that helping other people increase, our hedonic system is engaged to do it. Finally, accomplishment, and the message here about accomplishment for teachers is, what is the relationship of talent, IQ, perfect pitch to success in life as opposed to self-discipline and grit? And so we've quantified this and measured it in a variety of circumstances, and it turns out self-discipline is roughly accounts for about twice as much of the variance in success in the world as does talent. So what we want to maximize is self-discipline and grit. It's also the reason that girls do better than boys in grades in high school. Girls have more self-discipline, boys don't, and it accounts for the entire male-female difference. So to summarize that, there are a bunch of exercises that build PERMA. But importantly, I think the building of PERMA in South Australia, in schools, in the world, and the army is local. And it happens in the following way. So one of the important things about what Mr. Cameron is doing, he's not just measuring well-being, he's publishing the results. So it turns out that London has lower PERMA than any other part of England. Turns out that if you take Cambridge and Tunbridge Wells, they have about the same economics, but people in Tunbridge Wells have higher PERMA. What happens when those results are published? Well, if you're the head of the local authority in Cambridge and you don't want to lose your tax base to Tunbridge Wells, you start finding ways, not making gratitude visits, but doing things in Cambridge locally that build PERMA. So I believe in your school, Warren, in your corporation, if the boss says, we value PERMA, we're going to measure it, and now you can measure it by big data lexicon or questionnaires, and we're going to hold you accountable as a teacher, not just for improving geometry, but for improving the PERMA of your students. The teachers will find local ways of building PERMA. So it's the invisible hand that I think will be at work here. Now, let me wrap up here. What I've said is that we know something about how to do this at the individual level. Well, we also have learned a lot about how to do it in schools. So this is a study we did of kids who in the ninth grade had ninth grade literature with or without PERMA. So in the ninth grade in the United States, you read Lord of the Flies, Macbeth, The Scarlet Letter, Death of a Salesman, one awful tragedy after another. Not amazing that there's an epidemic of depression among young people that starts around the ninth grade. But what we did in half the classes is when you read Lord of the Flies, on Friday you had 80 minutes on kindness. And then the next Wednesday, you had the assignment to do three kind things. And this is what happens over the next 2 years. This is the social skills of the kids rated by the teachers. The teachers don't know what group they were in. And it turns out kids who have had Lord of the Flies with kindness have more cooperation, better self-control, more social skills. Similarly, grades are higher. So if you've had positive psychology with literature, in the honors group, everyone gets an A, so there's no effect. But for the non-honors group, your writing skills improve and your English grades go up. The brand new thing, signal event, comes from Alejandro Adler. Alejandro goes around the world teaching positive psychology. He's doing it in Bhutan, but also in Nepal, in India, and in Peru. He's off to Kazakhstan in March, since they want positive psychology taught in Kazakhstan. And what Alejandro did is he took 18 schools, and in 11 of them, he basically taught positive psychology and the kinds of exercises we're talking about, along with meditation, which is a value in Bhutan, and one of the documented positive psychology exercises. 7 of the schools were controls. He came back 15 months later and measured psychological well-being. So Peggy Kern and her colleagues have developed a very reliable questionnaire, which is a PERMA questionnaire for teenagers. And he found that in the 18 schools that had positive psychology, well-being had gone up. The numbers here are about 7,000 kids. But most importantly, this very first finding, the standardized achievement scores go up in the schools that have positive psychology. That's the answer to Michael Gove. No one had done that before. It says if the only thing you care about, you don't give a damn if the kids are happy. If the only thing you care about is literacy and numeracy, does making kids happier produce better literacy and numeracy? And Alejandro's answer in a very well-controlled study in Bhutan is it sure does. In this regard, it's important to mention what St. Peter's has founded. Simon Murray has founded an organization called PISA, the Positive Education Schools Association. It will probably go worldwide in March. And for those of you who are teachers, we urge you to join, and the website is there. So South Australia will is the fulcrum of the positive education movement. Since Rhonda Cornum is here, Rhonda was the general in charge of George Casey's initiative to build an army that was just as psychologically fit as physically fit. So under Rhonda's leadership, we've graduated our 20,000th drill sergeant. So 180 drill sergeants come for 8 days to the University of Pennsylvania, but now it's done in forts as well. And the drill sergeants learn the techniques of positive psychology. And then they teach the soldiers. And so well-being and its consequences are being measured actively in 1.1 million soldiers. And we can show you a little bit of the data. This is data from deployment to Iraq and Afghanistan. And it basically tells you when you're deployed, if you've had in your battalion one person who teaches positive psychology, coping skills go up during deployment when you're in Iraq and Afghanistan, and they go down if you haven't had that. And they recently published technical report number 4, in which they found that if you had in your company a positive psychology, what's called a master resilience trainer, substance abuse was decreased by about 50%, and the amount of post-traumatic stress disorder, panic disorder, and depressive disorder was significantly lower with master resilience trainers. So the Army has concluded that master resilience training is effective. So if you take together the evidence from Alejandro Adler, the white paper we've written on achievement and well-being, and what the U.S. Army has found, it says that South Australia is on the right track, that by bringing resilience training, by bringing positive psychology to the schools and mental health system of South Australia, we are very likely to see good effects, not only on how happy you are, but on achievement and physical health as well. So to conclude, what have we been smoking? Well, here's what we've been smoking. We've asked the question, holding economics constant, if we pursue more than just A, more than just money, what are the consequences of a state, of a public policy that's built around the increase in PERMA? And we can look into the large literature now, and here's essentially what we can ask. Now, we don't know this definitively, but places like Bhutan are starting to tell us, and very importantly, there are big doings in China. It's very hard for me to understand what's going on in China, but President Xi has declared 4 dreams for the next 10 years of China, and the 4th dream is well-being, and there have been articles in the China Daily in the last couple of months that argue that President Xi's dream of well-being is identical to South Australia and my dream of PERMA and positive psychology. So there is reason to believe that the Politburo will be moving top-down about the increasing of well-being. Now, I'm agnostic about this. So in South Australia, this is a democratic bottom-up movement. People are free to choose it. And I think it's a great experiment we're involved in, likely to work. What happens when an authoritarian government says we're going to increase well-being? Well, you've got 2 things going against each other. One is the exercises that increase well-being probably work, whether or not they're top-down or bottom-up. But I've spent my entire life working on freedom. And what we found from the first helplessness studies right up to Alejandro Adler's studies, is that if you take anything we value in life, if you choose it yourself and you accomplish it, it produces much more benefit than if it's given to you or done to you. So we will follow what happens in China with great interest. So what's in it for a world in which we're more than homo economicus? Well, we'll almost certainly have more PERMA by explicitly building PERMA. There is quite a large literature now on what happens to depression and anxiety when you increase PERMA. And it is likely that depression and anxiety will decrease. Better relationships, the skills of relationships, possible increase of PERMA. There's a fair amount of literature, which I talked about, that people with high PERMA have more success in life. So there is some reason to think that if all we care about is productivity and employment, that the building of PERMA will have a good effect in that regard. Physical health and healthcare expenditure, another literature and world that I'm involved in. If one looks at cardiovascular death and one looks at variables like optimism and other PERMA variables, the risk for cardiovascular death is markedly lower in optimistic people, people with high PERMA. And so there is some reason to believe that if South Australia is the mini world that increases PERMA in its schools and its mental health system, that physical health will increase and healthcare expenditure will decrease. So let me close with why I think it's important to smoke what we're smoking, why we're more than homo economicus. And it's Friedrich Nietzsche, I think, who told us about it. Nietzsche distinguishes three periods of human history. The first period he calls the camel. This is human beings who just lie there and take it and moan. And most of human history has been that. And then Nietzsche says the second period of both individual life and human history is saying no, identifying what's wrong in the world and saying no to racism, no to plague, no to Sharia, no to poverty. And I think you have to be blinded by ideology not to see that the politics of saying no has worked, that any variable that you care about, number of deaths on the battlefield, amount of pollution, amount of racism, amount of sexism, number of records, amount of education, violence, have all gotten better in the last 500 years. So the statistics on the increase in good things are on the rise. And it's very interesting that given that most of the objective things that we can measure, like decreases in violence, are much better off than we used to be, that depression and anxiety have not decreased. It's time for another lecture. But importantly, imagine that the politics of no worked and we got rid of all the things we wanted to say no to. Then Nietzsche says, well, what can we say yes to it? What is it that every parent wants for their children, that every religion, that every politics wants for the human future? What can we say yes to? And I suggest to you that that's what we've talked about tonight. That's what we're smoking, that all of us can say yes to more positive emotion in life. All of us can say yes to more engagement in our work with the people we love and in leisure. All of us can say yes to better relationships with the people we care about. All of us can say yes to more meaning and purpose in life. And all of us can say yes to more noble accomplishment. So my suggestion is, and I think South Australia is leading the way here, that the politics of the future, what we measure is not just how much money we earn, not just what the unemployment rate is, not just what the ratio of the rich to the poor is, but how much PERMA the citizens of the world have. Thank you.
Thank you, Martin. Another inspiring lecture for us in South Australia. We're so lucky to be hearing what's breaking news in the field, but also to be taken again through some of those core concepts and the core science. It's fantastic. We have only 10 minutes before we're due to close, so I think we really only have time for two or three questions. Martin, do you want to sit down or stay?
No, that's fine. So people come up.
So the microphone here. If you've got a question for Martin, I think we'll only get two or three done, but I'm happy to take the first comers to the microphone, please, and then Martin will answer your question. He prefers to do it this way. So can I have a first volunteer? Bev. And anyone else might like to line up behind Bev. Can we have a mic down there, please?
Thank you for your really inspiring talk tonight. You've talked a lot about the place...
Can you hear?
You've talked quite a lot about the place of PERMA in schools and in organisations like the Army. I'm wondering about your thoughts of the place that PERMA might have in working with people who are experiencing unemployment and helping them to get back into the workforce.
This is very much on my mind when I look at Lee Stevens and hearing a little bit about what's been happening in the north of this city. The question is, do we have something, does PERMA have something to contribute? And I have to say, we really don't know, because no one has ever had an awful opportunity like this before, which is 2.5 or 3 years before the plant closes, knowing that many thousands of people are going to lose their jobs. So it's an opportunity to take everything we know about well-being and life satisfaction and use it in a preventive program, measuring not just life satisfaction, depression, anxiety, drug use, but also reemployment. Now, very interestingly, we've talked with Number 10 Downing Street about this, and the leader of the Nudge Unit at Number 10 is someone called David Halpern, and they've been working with Welfare to Work using strength and PERMA teaching, and they have been able to increase the amount of reemployment by between 12 and 15% by identifying what your highest strength is, using that in a resume, et cetera. So Lee Stevens really has the opportunity to lead a very important experiment for the world in which we take what we know about positive education and we use it in this setting and we ask, does this help?
Thank you very much. Do we have any other questions?
Maddie, thank you again for a fantastic lecture, and thank you also for acknowledging mental health services in South Australia that we are trying to do some things differently. My question, though, is following on in relation to the presentation that Dr. Rhonda Cornham did at Seymour College earlier this week, and it was fantastic to hear her story and how she approached her story of survival, and as a fabulous woman in leadership, and as she took PERMA into the story and adapted that, which was a fantastic parallel. I'm really interested to know if, in terms of PERMA and the work that you've done and signature strengths, whether there is something unique that women do bring to leadership that in fact, you know, enables some of the stories, such as we've heard from Rhonda.
What a good question. And the answer is I don't know, but I have a hypothesis about it, and I used to have the title Professor of Leadership in my name of my professorship, but I've always been very skeptical about the notion of leadership, because I think what generals, school headmasters, CEOs do is very different, and that leadership is local and inhomogeneous. So I've been more interested in followership, which I think is homogeneous. So the question is, what is the measure of leadership from my perspective? So for me, across industry, schools, the military, the measure of a good leader would be how much do you increase the PERMA in your followers? And I think women are very good at increasing PERMA in others. So my guess would be that if we look at male versus female leaders and we measure impact on PERMA of followers, that we might see a gender difference. And if nothing else, finding the people who most increase PERMA is, for me, a way of selecting leaders.
I must admit that I didn't know much about this before, and I was kicked brought down here kicking and screaming because I didn't know anything about it. But I'm glad that I did come. You've actually intrigued me about a couple of things, but one of the things that you intrigued me is the talk about China and Bhutan. And I guess the question that I do have in a nutshell is, what is the impact of culture and technology? I mean, you talked about the top-down in China, for example, but it is probably the only way that that culture can cope with it. It will never go up from the bottom up.
Right.
And so the question is, the impact of culture and technology, and I think you can see it through generational change, does it work, or is it something that can probably only work in South Australia or in a certain Western culture? Where is the difference and the impact of culture and technology in this?
Well, again, I have to say I don't know is the real answer, but I can give you some speculations. There's quite a bit of cross-cultural work in positive psychology now. And the way I would describe, so Bhutan is an example of that, although the national language of Bhutan is English. I've come to believe that PERMA, positive emotion, engagement, relationships, meaning, and accomplishment, are universals, that this is what free people want. But the way they're manifested in different cultures is wildly different. So in India, for example, in the United States and Australia, shame is a negative emotion. In India, it's a positive emotion, what I'm told by my cross-cultural researchers. So how these things are manifested, I think, would be very different in cultures, and therefore how they're taught. Now, the second part of this is technology. And I think technology is a fantastic aid here. It's not just an aid to measurement. So I think we will come closer to finding out how much PERMA there is in the world because of Facebook and Twitter. But also, if we're to raise the flourishing of 7 billion people, it's got to be video games, movies, what technology brings. Now, technology has great costs, but one example, when you think about video games, you think about these shoot 'em up games like Grand Larceny 4.0 or whatever. But I keynoted a meeting 2 years ago of 400 pro-social gamers, people who build video games in which you're not doing shoot 'em up, but you're trying to solve water shortages in Africa. So I believe we can use the vehicle of video games in addition to teaching and face-to-face endeavors, and that technology is on our side.
If you see 10 young people socializing, sitting around the table, and you look at them, all they're doing is sitting on the phone doing this, and they don't seem to be able to interact with each other.
Yeah.
We are missing that human interaction,
yeah,
which you refer to as a relationship.
Yeah.
And as a result of that technology, we are missing the R, so it's not PERMA, it's now PIMA, or whatever it is.
Yeah.
And as such, I mean, the impact of that on positive development of humans, young and old,
right.
Well, it's probably not positive.
I take what you're saying seriously. People said the same thing about the telephone as well, that people would spend all their time on the telephone. So I think these things tend to sort out. So there is some reason to think that the people who are doing this all day long are actually more depressed and anxious than the people who aren't. And if that's so, that will get sorted out. People will do less of it because it's costly. So I think when you compare the possibility of 1.3 billion Chinese having access to gratitude visits, for example, versus the dangers of sitting around on your iPhone all day, I think technology on balance is on our side.
There are a number of us who are working in the areas of developing well-being. Can you give us some guidance on how we could work together better in South Australia to measure PERMA and to build PERMA?
Well, I think Gabe is in a better position to answer that than I. South Australia has come together with a lot of people teaching it and measuring it. And I guess, Gabe, can you tell us about what the state of South Australia is doing about statewide measurement?
There have been four wellbeing questions added to a statewide measure that is managed through University of Adelaide, but the results of that are not yet clear yet. There's been a trial of 175 schools being involved with a middle years development instrument as a pilot project run by the Department for Education and Child Development. But frankly, we're still entering this land of measurement and universal measurement, and we've got a lot still to learn together. Many schools are exploring on their own and many are exploring together. We're having a wellbeing measurement symposium tomorrow with many international guests with us to really look at this question. Martin has convinced us, I think everybody that I'm aware of agrees that we must measure before we intervene, whether we're going into schools or aged care settings or the health system or prisons or wherever we decide to do our work. And together as a state, we need to come to a concerted view as to what the measurement tool will be and what will be the research methodology we will use to gather that material together so that we can really track our progress. So we're still sorting that out. Some people are racing ahead and wanting to go with the interventions. We're saying, no, please stop. A number of schools are doing measurement and wellbeing interventions already, such as St Peter's College and a number of other key schools, and Mount Barker High School and others, but we're still working on how to approach this as a state together. We loosely talk, we've coined this crazy word, which is a kind of a velvet lasso around all of us, so that we can move together in a concerted way and use the research that we can gain across the state to really learn and also demonstrate to the rest of the world what's possible. But it is a beginning.
There's a second very important thing embedded in your question. So Simon Murray was able to found PISA, the Positive Education Schools Association. So maybe Samurai could found SAPE, the South Australia Positive, I don't quite have it. But the question is to form a group of people, since there are so many people working in the mental health system, positive education, and fire and police as well, on what the best practices are. So I think what you're saying is how can we share best practices? And that's the kind of thing that I think Samurai or the government could use its web to build.
Absolutely, and it's at the heart of the mission of the new Wellbeing and Resilience Centre, because everybody is aware that we do need somebody to unify this work into the future. And as Steve was saying, that is going to happen. So thank you so much. Martin, may I just say once again, thank you very much for your lecture this evening and for coming back to see us and helping us, firstly, giving us this bold vision and then helping us to move forward with it. Can I ask you to thank Martin Seligman?